Hello and welcome to ISTQB Foundation Level Syllabus. Today we are going to cover chapter number 1, that is Fundamentals of Testing. For this chapter, the assigned timing is 175 minutes. So I will take 175 minutes of yours to cover this chapter. This chapter has few keywords which you need to concentrate on while going through the chapter. Along with the keywords, we also have certain learning objectives. We have five learning objectives, the five main learning objectives. And the first one is, what is testing? Then is, why is testing necessary? Third topic is, seven testing principle, test process, and the psychology of testing. So these are the five main topics which we are going to cover in chapter one. Along with this topic, or when we are covering this topic, you will also come across these keywords. So these keywords are also important from the exam point of view. So let's first concentrate on the keywords. The first one is coverage. So when you are going through the chapter, whenever you come across coverage, we will try to explain over there that what is the meaning of the coverage. Then similarly, the next topic is debugging. Defect, error, failure, quality, quality assurance, root cause, test analysis, test basis, test cases, test completion, test condition, test control, test data, test design, test execution, test implementation, test monitoring, test object, test objective, test oracle, test planning, test procedure, test process, test suits, testing, test wear, traceability, and verification and validation. All these keywords we are going to see when we are covering chapter number one. And that time you have to concentrate, you have to understand the meaning of each of these words. Now, this will be our reference, and as per the syllabus, we will cover the topic. So as per the syllabus, the first topic is, what is testing? So here we are going to see the definition of testing. Okay. So what is software testing? Let's see the definition. Software testing is a way to assess the quality of the software and to reduce the risk of the software failure in operation. So we have 2 points here. First one, we perform testing to assess the quality of the software, to evaluate the quality of the software. And along with that, we perform testing to reduce the risk of the software failure. Let's understand this point. So once we develop the software, if we give it to the user without performing testing, then all the defects which are present in the software will be seen or visible to the user while he is using the product. Whereas if the software is developed and if it passed through a process where we can find the defects so that the user will not find those defects. Such process is called testing. So we develop the software, we pass it through the process, that process is testing. During this process, what we do is we find the defects, we find the bugs, and then if we find the bugs, we fix them, and then we deliver it to the user. So what is the disadvantage? If we directly develop the software and give it to the user, then that user will find the bugs, which is not good for the company and for the product also. So that's why you have to remember this definition. Software testing is a way to assess the quality of the software and to reduce the risk of the software failure in operation. Now, why software testing is required? So we answered part of it in the previous slide, and now we will answer it further. For an example, we use softwares in business applications as well as customer products. When we say business application, that means when you go to airport for booking your tickets, any ticket booking system, or when you go to supermarket for the billing system, or when you are working in an office, everywhere we use the software. Then if we come to the customer products that are like washing machine or the mobile phones which runs on the software, and then the coffee maker machine. All customer products which uses software or any business application which uses software, what are we expecting from them? We want them to work fine whenever we use them. So this is what is our expectation. But what will happen if the software is not working correctly? In such scenario, we call the software as a faulty software. And if you have a faulty software, then it will have some negative consequences. For an example, loss of money, loss of time, company reputation, or sometime it will result in injury or death. Let's understand this in more detail. The first point is loss of money. For an example, this was an article which was published in 2000. It was published in 2006 or 2012, that Toyota has recalled almost 2000 of its car due to some fault in the airbag system. So there was a fault in the airbag system because of which Toyota has recalled their car. If such type of issue is in the market, then it will result in loss of money because you have to repair all this product now. Okay. Next is loss of time. Now, if such news is in the market, the company has to bring all the impacted car to the garage where they will undergo repair, and at the same time, the company has to do the damage control. Yeah, they will bring it to the garage, then they will do the repair activity, and it will be of free of cost. So all these things will require a lot of time. So loss of time is also one of the consequences of faulty software. Next point is loss of reputation. So this is another article which was published in 2014, that there was a security breach in the eBay software. So if we hear certain such type of news, for example, if the banking software, if we hear that the banking software is faulty and the data is compromised, then such article or such news will result in the reputation of the company. Company will lose its reputation. And the last one and the most critical one is the injury or death. So this is an airbag system, and you see that the airbag system didn't work properly. There is a leakage over here. That means there is some fault. And such type of fault will result in injury or death. So what we learned is, if we have a faulty software, then it may result in loss of money, loss of time, loss of reputation, or sometime injury or death. So let's summarize all the points which we covered till now. So first we covered the definition of testing. Software testing is a way to assess the quality of the software and to reduce the risk of the software failure in operation. And if the software does not work correctly, such softwares are called as faulty software. And the impact of faulty softwares are loss of money, loss of time, loss of reputation, and injury or death. So this is all about what is testing and if the software is not working as we want it to work. Now let's move to the next topic. That is software testing misconceptions. So there are many misconceptions in the company or outside regarding testing, and that is what we are going to cover now. So there are three misconceptions which is mentioned in the ISTQB syllabus, and that is what we are going to see here. Testing only consists of running test cases. So this is a misconception that testing only consists of running test cases. Next, testing only involves the execution of the component or system being tested. So this is the second consequence where we think testing means execution of the component or system. The last one is testing focuses entirely on verification of the requirement. So here we are saying the last point is that during testing we only perform the verification process. So three misconceptions are there. First one is that we think we are only running the test cases. Running test cases means testing, that is complete testing. Next one is during testing we only execute the test cases. Third one is we only perform verification process. Let's understand them in more detail. So the first misconception is testing only consists of running test cases, which is not correct. In upcoming lecture you will see testing has four different processes. Okay, inside testing we follow seven processes, and the processes are test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, test completion. So we have a lot of thing to do in testing. Testing does not mean only running test cases. We have to plan, we have to monitor what we have planned, we have to analyze the requirement, we have to design the test cases, we have to implement our test cases, then we execute the test case, and then once everything is done, then we collect the report. In the upcoming lecture we will cover them in more detail, but right now as far as this lecture is concerned, you just need to know that testing only consists of running test case is a misconception. Moving further, the second misconception is testing only involves the execution of the component or system being tested. So here they are telling during testing we execute the test cases. If we execute the test case, then only we can call it as a testing, which is false. It is a misconception, because during testing we perform dynamic testing, which is very common, as well as we perform static testing. What is the difference between dynamic testing and static testing? During dynamic testing we will execute the code, whereas during static testing the code are not executed. Here we are not executing the code, whereas in dynamic testing we execute the code. We will cover this topic in more detail in the upcoming lecture, but for time being just remember testing only involves the execution of the component or system being tested is a misconception. Let's see the third one. Similar to the second one, we have the third point. Testing focuses entirely on verification of the requirement. This is also a misconception. Testing involves verification, which that is right. Along with verification, testing also involves validation. What is the difference between verification and validation? Verification will happen when you are developing the product. And during verification, we check, are we building the right product? Are we building the product right? So once few set of requirements are implemented, we check whether those requirements are implemented correctly or not. Likewise, when next set of requirements are implemented, then we test those. So slowly and steadily what we see that whether we are building a product right or not. Whereas validation will come in the later stage. Here we see that build the right product. So the product will be ready. If you have 100 requirements, then all 100 requirements are implemented correctly or not. That is what we are going to see. That means we are going to see whether whatever product we want to implement, whether we have implemented it correctly or not. Whereas in verification stage, we check like first 10 requirements, 20 requirements, 30 requirements. Slowly, we will build the confidence that we are building the right product. So this is the main difference. During verification you check building the product right. During validation you check whether we have built the right product. I hope it is clear now. So testing focuses entirely on verification of the requirement is a misconception. Verification as well as validation we do. So let's summarize all the points. So we studied three points. Three misconceptions, that is, testing only consists of running the test cases is a misconception. There are many other steps which we do, like I said, planning, analysis, design, implementation, execution. So all these steps are done apart from only running the test cases. Next point is, testing only involves the execution of the component or system being tested. During testing, we execute the test cases, but that is not only one way of testing. Without executing the test cases also, we can do testing. That is called static testing. Last point is, testing focuses entirely on verification of the requirement. So this is also false. This is a misconception, because during testing, we perform verification as well as validation. Okay, so this is all about the misconceptions of testing. Now let's see one question and then try to solve this one. So here the question is, what is the main reason for testing software before releasing it? So why are we doing testing? To show that the system will work after release. This looks right, but is this the purpose? Let's see. By reading other options, we will find out whether this is the right one or not. B, to decide when the software is of sufficient quality to release. So here we check that when the software is ready for the release, whether it is meeting the sufficient quality or not. That is what we are checking here. Let's see, this is also looking right. C, to find as many bugs as possible before release. Yeah, we do testing to find bug. Okay, so this also looks right. D, to give information for a risk-based decision about release. Okay, this also looks right, that okay, we have to provide the risk-based decision. Now what we need to do is, we have to find out which one is the best fit here. All looks fine, but then only one answer is right over here, and that is what we need to find. So to show that the system will work after release, we don't do testing to show that it, yeah, obviously the software should work after we release it, but we don't do testing for that purpose. We do testing to find the bug. That is straightforward. So that is why option A is not the answer. Our job is not to show that the software is working fine. As a tester, our job is to show that the software is not working fine. Okay, so that's why option A is not the answer. B, to decide when the software is of sufficient quality to release. This is also a little bit tricky to say that yes, it is of sufficient quality. You will not find any bug in the software, which we will cover in some time, that finding all the defect is not in our hand. Okay, so whether we have achieved the sufficient quality or not, that depends on many other factors. So just by this statement, we cannot say that okay, that is why we do testing. To find as many bugs as possible. Again, this is a vague statement. As many bugs means what? How many bugs? So that is also not in our hand. If the same software is there and if we perform testing 10 times, we may find different bugs. We may find a new bug on 10th time. So that's why as many bugs as possible is also not the exact point which we need to perform during the testing. The last one is to give information for a risk-based decision about release. We perform this testing. Why? After this testing, we will release the software. While releasing the software, we have to provide our input. As a testing team, we have to provide input to the management saying that what is the quality of our system? Are there any risks associated with this software? And that is why option B is the answer. That is the most appropriate answer among all three, or among all four. I hope you got it, why D is the answer. Now let's move to the next topic. So we covered what is testing, and now we will cover typical objectives of testing. So if you see here, it is of type K1. That means you will get a direct question from this chapter, this topic. So now what we will see the objective of testing, why we perform testing, right? So let's see 7 objectives of testing. That is what we are going to cover now. As I already said, that it is of type K1. That means you are going to get a direct topic from this topic. Now, before we start this topic, what you need to know is 2 main terms. They're very important, and these terms are used throughout the syllabus. That is why you need to know what is work product and what is test item. What is the meaning of these words? When we say work product, what should you think? And when we say test item, then what should you think? What should come to your mind? So when we say work product, that means output. Let's understand this point. So this is a typical flow in which a company works. So usually in a company, we get the requirement. We get the requirement from the user or from the customer. By looking into this requirement in the company, we develop the system requirement. From system requirement, then we design or we do global design and detailed design. Once the design is ready, we implement the code. So this is a typical process. Now, what is the meaning of work product here? As I said, work product means output. So when you are in the system engineering state, what are you doing? System requirement stage, you are writing the requirement. So the output of this stage is requirement. So requirement is the output. When you are in the global design stage or the detailed design stage, in this stage, you are developing the design. So design is your output. When you are in the implementation stage, here you have the code. So code is going to be your output. So here the work product is requirement. Here the work product is design document. And here the work product is code. I hope now it is clear. Work product means output of that stage, or simply output. Let's move to the next term, that is test item. So test item can be any document, or it could be any component or system which is under test. So whatever you get for testing is referred as test item. Let's understand this point again. So we understood this flowchart, and I said when you are in the system requirement state, then requirement is your output. Suppose this requirement you give it for review, for testing, then the same requirement document is called as test item. When it is an output, then it is called as a work product, and this work product when undergoes testing, it is referred as test item. Let's understand with this stage also. So when you are in the implementation stage, the output is code. It will be referred as work product. When this code is used for testing, when the testing is performed in this code, then the code is referred as test item. So you can have test item as a document, as well as you can have a test item as a code or software. So this is what is the meaning of test item. Document, component, or system under test. So whatever is under test is referred as test item, or it can be anything like document, component, or system. I have both the points are now clear. The first point was work product and then the test item. Now let's see the seven objectives of testing, and these objectives are very, very important from exam point of view. The first objective is to evaluate work product. So I hope now you are able to remember what is the meaning of work product. To evaluate work product such as requirement, user stories, design, and code. Anything, any document which comes, the objective of testing is to evaluate them. This is the first objective, is to evaluate the work product. Now work product can be anything, okay? So I already explained this. So if you are in any of this stage and if you give the output, that output should be evaluated before going to the next stage. So this is the objective of testing, that evaluate the output or the work product of each stage. So this is the objective number one, to evaluate work product such as requirement, user stories, design, and code. You have to remember them. That's why I'm repeating it again and again. Let's move to objective two. So first one was is to evaluate them, and then is to verify whether all specific requirements have been fulfilled or not. So we have to evaluate. Along with the evaluation, we have to see that whatever is there in the requirement, whether we are able to fulfill those requirements or not. That is what we have to verify here. For an example, if you get this as a requirement, the requirement is for web page, when the login details is given, the next page shall load in few milliseconds, and if login details are not correct, then show a pop-up. So this is the requirement. Now we have to verify whether this requirement is complete or not. So when we read this requirement, there are few points which we get. For example, the first point is few milliseconds means how much time. So here they say, for web page, when the login detail is given, the next page shall load in few milliseconds. But the millisecond related information is not available. So we have to ask this question. So this is the purpose of testing. This is the objective, to verify. Then which page will load next? They said that whenever this happens, then the next page shall load. But what is the content of the next page that is missing? So we have to ask this. What is the pop-up content? So at the end they say that if the login details are not correct, then show a pop-up. But they are not saying what should be the content of the pop-up. So these are the informations which are missing, and this is the objective of testing, to verify whether all the specified requirements have been fulfilled or not, fulfilled or complete or not. Moving to the next objective. So first one was to evaluate, then is to verify, and next one is to validate. To validate whether the test object is complete and works as the user and other stakeholders expect it to work. I already said validation will come towards the end. Here we have to see whatever product which we build is working as per the user's need or as per the stakeholders' need or not. So this is the third objective, to validate. So as I said, or as we saw this diagram here, suppose you are in the requirement stage. The output of this requirement stage will be used during the designing. Similarly, whatever is the output of the design stage will be used for the implementation. So we have to see that whatever is the output is matching what we need here or not. Okay, so this is what we have to understand in objective 3. To validate whether the test object is complete and works as the user and other stakeholders expect it to work. This also we saw previously, right? That the login page related requirement. So now what we will do is, so this is the code which is written. Validation means we will just give the input, like what user will do. User will just provide the input. Once the user provides the input, whether the user is getting the expected output or not, we are not bothered about how the code is written. What we are bothered about is, if we give certain input, like if I give a correct login detail, the output should be that I am inside the website, whether that is happening or not. So that is what we will check, and that means we are performing a validation over here. Moving to the fourth objective, that is to build confidence in the level of quality of the test object. We also have to build confidence in the level of the quality. So if we perform certain testing, then we know that if those scenarios will come, the software will behave as it should behave. So we will build the confidence in the level of the quality of the test object. Same example, if you perform testing at the requirement level, so here the requirement document will be available. If you perform testing on it, then you are confident that whatever product you have or whatever output you have, we can use this output for the design phase. Otherwise, what will happen if you don't perform testing? If there is any mistake in the requirement, it will be passed on to the other stages. But if we find it in this stage, we are confident that now the requirement is fine and the remaining steps will be fine based on this requirement. So this is how we can build the confidence in the level of the quality of the test object. And you know what is the meaning of test object? Whatever you are testing, that will be referred as a test object. Then objective 5 is a very common objective, to find defects and failure thus reduce the level of risk of inadequate software quality. So if we find the bugs here, all these stages, if we find more bugs here, then we know that we have found a lot of bug, and now the software is ready for use for the next stage. So this is the objective of testing, to find bugs, to find failures in a stage where we are performing the testing. Okay, to find defects and failure, thus reduce the quality, thus reduce the level of risk of inadequate software quality. So we reduce the risk of bad software quality. Next one. To provide sufficient information to the stakeholders. The objective of testing is not only to find the bugs, to defect, build confidence, and evaluate, verify. Those are the objectives. Along with that, we also have to provide sufficient information to the stakeholders to allow them to make informed decisions. If there are bugs in the software, we have to inform to the stakeholder on time so that they can take the decision, especially regarding the level of the quality of the test object. So whatever you're testing, whatever is the risk associated with that, you have to inform that to the stakeholders, and for that we perform testing. So this is one of the important points. Now the last one, that is the objective number 7. To comply with contractual, legal or regulatory requirements or standards, and to verify the test objects compliance with such requirement or standards. So what they are saying here is, along with informing it to the customer or stakeholders, we have to see that whatever contract we have, whatever legal related requirements we have for our work product, or whatever regulatory requirements with, like, for if you are working for an automotive industry, then they will have some standards which you need to follow. So whether those standards we are following it or not in our test object. So whatever test object we get for testing, whether that test object is in compliance with the contract which we made with the customer, is it meeting the legal requirement or the regulatory related requirements, that we need to find out. That is also the objective of the testing. I hope it is clear now, the 7 objectives of testing. So as I said, for automotive industry, we have the standard ISO 26262, which looks for the safety related issue. So we have to see that we are following this standard when we are developing an automotive related requirement. Now, the last point and an important one, the objective of testing is context dependent. Whatever objective we studied till now, 7 objectives, they are generalized objectives. It is not necessary that we have to apply all those objectives to all the product which we are developing. We also have to see the context. Let's see what is the meaning of that. Suppose you are at the component testing level, or you are at the acceptance testing level. Now we will see how the objective will vary when you are at the component testing level and when you are at the acceptance testing level. When you are at the component testing level, your main objective is to find as many bugs as possible. This is the main objective when you are in the component testing level. Whereas when you are at the acceptance testing level, this is not your objective. Your objective is not to find as many bugs as possible. Whereas your objective is to confirm that the system works as expected and satisfies the requirement. When customer is performing this acceptance testing, the customer does not want to see the bugs. They want to see that whatever you have developed is meeting their requirement so that they can accept the product. Whereas when we are doing the component testing, this is done internally, and we want to find as many bugs as possible so that these bugs are not visible to the customer. So now you can see that when you are at different level of testing, the objective is different. That is why we say the objective of testing is context dependent. I hope this statement is clear now. Moving further, We will summarize all the points now. Okay, so these are the 7 objectives which we covered. First one, to prevent defects by evaluating the work products such as requirements, user stories, design and code. Then, to verify whether all specified requirements have been fulfilled. This also we have to verify whether we are fulfilling all the requirements or not. To check whether the test object is complete and validate if it works as the user and the stakeholders expect it to work. So we perform the validation. We also have to build the confidence in the level of the quality of the test object. Okay, next. To find defect and failures, thus reduce the risk of level of risk of inadequate software quality. Next, to provide sufficient information to the stakeholder to allow them to make informed decisions, especially regarding the quality of the risk of the software or regarding the test object. To comply with contractual, legal or regulatory requirement or standards and to verify the test object compliance with such requirement and standard. Now, if you are thorough with this, it is fine. You can continue. Otherwise, you can pause the video, read it by yourself once, because we are going to solve some questions based on this topic. So let's see the quiz now. This is the first question. Which of the following is a major objective of testing? Here you have to concentrate on word major. Okay. To prevent defect. Yes, we perform testing to prevent defect. That is right. B, to evaluate the project plan works as expected or required. To gain confidence in the development team. To make release decision for the system under test. So release related information or decision we don't make. It is made by the customer, is made by the manager or someone from the management, not by us. So if we see here, the answer should be A, because this is the straightforward. The whole purpose or the whole objective of testing is to prevent defect. Okay. Next one. Which of the following is a typical objective? Okay, typical objective of testing, that is what they mean. Preventing defect, repairing defect, comparing actual result to the expected result, analyzing the cause of the failure. So here also it is similar, that the answer is preventing defect. We perform, this is the objective. Next one. So this one is a different one. Which of the following statement is a valid objective for testing? Again, they are talking about valid objective. The test should start as late as possible so the development team had enough time to create a good product. Are we doing testing to satisfy the development team? No. To find as many failures as possible so that defect can be identified and correct. So this could be one of the objectives, that find as many failures as possible. Okay. C, to prove that all possible defects are identified. As a tester, you cannot prove that you have identified all the defects. So this should be a straightforward no for you. D, to prove that any remaining defect will not cause any failure. This also we cannot say, because if there is a defect, then it may cause a failure, right? So D also we cannot say. So while reading all this thing, from here what we see is that option B is the answer. To find as many failures as possible so that defect can be identified and corrected. Next one. When the tester verifies the test basis while designing test early in the life cycle, which common test objective is being achieved? So here what they are doing is, the tester is performing testing early in the life cycle. If they do that, what they are achieving? Gaining confidence, finding defect, preventing defect, providing information for decision making. If you see, all of these are the objective of testing. But if you find defects early, then what you will achieve? For that, the answer is C. providing information for decision making. If you get, for an example, if there is a product, very first day you found that it is unstable. Now, if you find that information, obviously you are gaining, are you gaining the confidence? Yes, you will gain the confidence that your testing is good. You will find, you found the defect also, you are preventing the defect. But the most important thing is you are providing information for decision making. Now the development team can make a decision that the software is unstable and they can perform certain activity. So we perform testing, especially at the service level, to provide information as early as possible. So if you perform early testing, then you can give this information early. That's why option D is the answer. Why is software testing sometimes required for legal reasons? Why we have to perform testing? For the legal reasons. Okay, let's see. It prevents developer from suing tester. So whether developer will sue the tester, that is one aspect here. That is not the case. Contracts may specify testing requirement that must be fulfilled. Okay. C. International laws require software testing for exported products. Only for the exported products, not for the imported one or the one which is developed in the country itself. For that, there is no law. Testing across system must be accompanied by legal documentation. Here, if you see option B, contracts may specify testing requirement. Yes, when we deal with the customer, we get a contract. And in the contract, it should be mentioned what all things we should cover. It can be a legal requirement also. So all these things should be included in the contract. So we perform testing for the legal reasons if it is mentioned in the contract. So contract may specify testing requirement that must be fulfilled. So this is one of the question. Next one, which of these are objectives of software testing? So this is quite simple, I think. Determine the productivity of the programmer. Are we going to check the productivity of the programmer by testing? No. Eliminate the need for future program maintenance. So in future, in program, whatever maintenance we have to do, can we avoid that if we do the testing now? Eliminate every error prior to release. Uncover software error. Uncover means finding the defects. So here the answer should be D. We cannot, as I said already, we cannot find all the defects. It is not possible to find all the defects. And then we cannot say that in future we will not require a maintenance activity. And obviously we are not doing testing to validate the programmer's productivity. That's not the intention. The intention is to uncover the software errors. Next one. Which of the following should not normally be an objective of a test? So here you have to concentrate on a word not. Most of the time people make mistake over here. They don't read not, and then in a hurry they just mark the objective of testing. So please don't do that mistake. Please pay attention to the word not. First one, to find fault in the software. So this is right. To assess whether the software is ready for release. Yes, we perform testing to see that, to determine that, to analyze that whether it is ready for release or not. To demonstrate that the software does not work. Okay. Or D, to prove that the software is correct. Remember one thing. The idea of testing is not to show that the software is working fine. It is always to show that the software is not working fine. So therefore, here the answer is D. This is not the objective of testing. We are not performing testing to show that the software is correct. This is another type of question which we can get in the exam. Let's see what it is. Which all are correct with respect to objective of testing? Okay, so now we have to go through all of them. To provide sufficient information to the stakeholder, yes, one is right. So if you see in the option, only in three options one is there. That means C is anyways wrong here. So you are left with B, A, B and D. To show that software is working correctly, as I said, this should be a straightforward no. We are not performing testing to show that software is working correctly. So 2 is not the option. So if you see option A has 2, so this is also you can eliminate. And then you are left with B and D. So it has 1, 3 and 4 are not correct, and here it has 1, 3 and 4 are correct. So 1 is correct anyways. Looks like option D is the answer. Let's see. Or okay. And 3, what is that? To reduce the level of risk of inadequate software quality. Yes, it is a straightforward objective. 4, to comply with contractual, legal or regulatory requirements. So yes, option D is the answer. 1, 3 and 4 are correct objective of testing. Okay, so now what we will do is, so with that what we covered is identify typical objectives of testing. So this is what we covered. Now we will move to the next topic, which is the important one, that is differentiate testing from debugging. So now we are going to see the testing and debugging concept. Definitely you will get one question from this topic also. Okay, so first of all, let's see what are the activities we perform during testing. Testing shows the failure. We perform testing to show the failures and check defect is fixed or not. So first we will show the failure, we will find the defect, then we will test again to see that the defect is fixed or not. Last one, testing is done by the tester. These are the 3 points. We perform testing to show the failure, means to find the bug, to find the failure, to find the defects. Then we check whether the defect is fixed or not by doing retesting. And at the end, you should know testing is done by the tester. Now moving to the debugging activity. So here, during the debugging, what we do is we analyze the failure. During testing, what we do, we find the failure. During debugging, we analyze the failure. Then we fix the defect. Here we fix the defect. First, we analyze the failure. Based on our analysis, we fix the defect. And all these things are done by, that means debugging is done by the developers. Testing is done by the testers. And debugging is done by the developers. Now, we should know the workflow between testing and development activity. As we know, during testing, we find the failure. This is what we will get. Once we find a lot of failure, what we do is we report it to the development team. Once the development team gets this report, the development team will investigate the failures. While analyzing or while investigating, what developers will do is they will isolate the defect. So they will find out in which feature that defect is there. Once they isolate the defect or they find the feature, they will fix the defect. After fixing, they will also check whether it is working fine or not. Once they are sure that okay, it is working fine, then they will report it to the testing team. And then testing team will do the retesting to confirm that defects are fixed. I hope now it is clear. So here the testing team is finding the defect, and once the defect is fixed, they are also retesting it to see that the defect is fixed or not. So this is all about the workflow of testing and debugging. Now moving further, what we saw till now is that testing is done by the tester, but in case of agile development and in some other life cycles, testers may be involved in debugging and component testing. We can involve tester in the debugging activity, but here the scope of the tester is very limited. Only in case of development, agile development, we may involve tester for testing, but the scope of, we may involve tester in debugging, but the scope of debugging is limited. Whereas in general, testing is done by the tester and debugging is done by the developer. That is what you need to remember as far as agile development is not concerned. Now, we will see the difference between testing and debugging. Testing is performed by the testers, it is clear. Debugging is done by the developers. Then, find the programming failures. During testing, we find the programming failures. Whereas during debugging, we demonstrate that the program is working fine. So once the debugging is done, we show that the program is working fine. Main difference. The third and the last difference is the purpose of testing is to show the failures that are caused by the defect. So if there is a defect in the software, then by testing we show that. Whereas debugging, we find, analyze and fix the defect. So first we have to find where the defect is present. We have to analyze it, and based on the analysis we have to fix the defect. So these were the three differences between testing and debugging. Now let's summarize this point. With this, what is testing is will be completed. The first point is testing is done by the tester. Debugging is done by the developers. Purpose of testing is to show failure that are caused by defects in the software. Purpose of debugging is to find, analyze and fix such defects. Only in case of agile development model, there is an exception where debugging may be done by testers with limited scope. So now you can go through it, but if you are clear, then we will start with the quiz. So the first quiz is, who would usually perform debugging activity? I think this is straightforward. Who has to perform debugging activity? It is done by the developers, right? Moving to the next one, debugging is, they're asking you the definition of debugging now. Testing or checking whether the software performs correctly. Okay. Checking that a previously reported defect has been corrected. No, this is part of testing. Identifying the cause of a defect, repairing the code and checking the fix is correct. So option C is the answer, but let's see the last one. Checking that no unintended consequences have been occurred as a result of fix. This is also part of the testing only. So option C is the answer here, because during debugging we identify the defect, then we repair the defect and then we check that it is working fine or not. Next one, according to the ISTQB, what is debugging? It is part of a fundamental testing process, includes the repair of the cause of the failure, involves intentionally adding unknown defects, no, following the steps of a test procedure. Answer is B, includes the repair of the cause of the failure. So whatever is the failure, whatever is the cause, we try to repair during the debugging activity, that is a fixing activity. So option B is the answer. Next one. Which one of the following describes best the difference between testing and debugging? This question is also very important, that what is the difference between testing and debugging, and that is how they ask question. This is a question which was asked in ISTQB. Testing shows failure that are caused by the defect. Yes. Debugging finds, analyzes and removes the cause of the failure in the software. Straightforward, A looks like A is the answer. Let's see other options also. Testing pinpoints the defect. Debugging analyzes the fault and proposes preventing activities. Mm-hmm. Testing removes fault. Debugging identifies the cause of the failure. Dynamic testing prevents cause of the failure. Debugging removes the failure. Cause of the failure is found by the debugging. So A is the answer again here. As I said, testing shows the failure that are caused by the defect. Debugging finds, analyzes and removes the cause of a failure in a software. Let's see the next question. Yeah. Which of the following is an example of debugging? A tester finds a defect and reports it. Okay. A tester retests a fix from the developer and finds a regression. Mm-hmm. A tester finds and fixes the defect. Sorry, a developer finds and fixes the defects. Yes, debugging is done by the developer. Developer finds the problem and then they fix the defect. Option C is the answer. So I hope it is clear. Let's see the next one. This is also a simple one. Which of the following is the activity that removes the cause of the failure? Cause of the failure. Who removes the cause of the failure? Debugging. Testing, dynamic testing, debugging, reverse engineering, debugging. C is the answer. Last one. So this is also one of the question which was asked in ISTQB or by the ISTQB. Debugging and testing are key activities in the software development lifecycle. Which of the following are debugging activity? What they are saying is debugging and testing both are very important activity. But now out of this, which one is a debugging activity? Identifying a failure. Locating the cause of the failure. Yes, locating the cause of the failure is debugging. Fixing the defect. Yes, fixing the defect is also a failure. That means B and C are the answer. Checking the fix has been resolved the failure. So checking is done by the testing activity. So answer should be C here. Yes, the answer is C. So with this, the first part of chapter 1 is done. That is, what is testing?